Amen. All right, take your Bibles when you find it, stand. Only when you find it. Don't stand up if you don't find it. St. John chapter 8. I want to see how long you take to find it. Talking all the Bible talk. Hope you could see it now. And I want you also to turn to Ezekiel chapter 3. Ezekiel chapter 3. Amen? Praise God. I'm in John chapter 8.
Yes, we are.
Amen. All right, the rest of you who didn't find it, you can stand now. And listen, stop looking, because if you're looking while we're reading, you're going to miss it. Amen? Jesus went under the Mount of Olives, and early in the morning he came again into the temple, and all the people came unto him, and he sat down and taught them. And the scribes and Pharisees brought unto him a woman taken in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they say unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. Now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned, but what sayest thou? This they cried, tempting him, that they might have to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down. Somebody say, stooped down.
Stooped down.
And with his finger wrote on the ground, as though he heard them not. So when they continued asking him, he lifted up himself and said unto them, He that is without sin among you, cast the first stone. And they all, I don't know if they look at the writing or what they did, but they all dropped their stone and walked away one by one. Then he turned to the woman and he said, Woman, where are those thine accusers? And she said, None, Lord. And then he said, Well, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. Amen. Now turn over to Ezekiel. Let's look at something here. Ezekiel chapter 3. Let's read from verse 12. Then the Spirit took me up, and I heard behind me a voice of a great rushing, saying, Blessed be the glory of the Lord from his place. I heard also the noise of the wings of the living creatures that touched one another, and the noise of the wheels over against them, and a noise of a great rushing. So the Spirit lifted me up and took me away, and I went in bitterness in the heat of my spirit, but the hand of the Lord was strong upon me. Did you hear that? I went in the heat of my bitterness. I was ready, you know, I was ready. When I came to them of the captivity of Tel Aviv, and I think sometimes we say Tel Aviv, amen? That dwelt by the river of Sheba, and I sat where they sat, and remained there astonished among them 7 days. And it came to pass at the end of 7 days that the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, I have made thee a watchman unto the house of Israel. Therefore hear the word at my mouth, and give them warning from me. I want to speak to my leaders especially, and I will speak to everybody, so don't feel left out. Amen? And I want to say to you that before you speak, and to those of you that are Christians, and those of you that are witnesses, and to those of you that want to make Jesus Lord of your life and work in the kingdom, before you speak, there are some things you need to do. Don't start talking to anybody. Don't get preaching and, you know, hallelujah, until you do these things. That's what I want to talk about. Is that all right?
Yes.
Amen. Amen. I don't know how to put a fancy name for it, but there's a few things I heard, learned. Some I studied, some I bootlegged, and all the rest of it. But I like it.
Yeah.
I like it. And I want to share it with you. Amen. So that it can bless your life. And it can strengthen you. And we can see, not from our perspective, or from man's perspective, but from God's perspective.
Amen.
Is that all right? Lift your hands with me. Our Father and our God, we give you thanks, we give you praise, we give you honor and glory. I thank you for this glorious opportunity where I can stand before your people, which is so great a people, Lord, to declare the unadulterated word of God, to declare the mysteries of the Father. Oh God, grant me a tongue of the learned that I would speak a word in season to someone that might be weary. Help me to help somebody that my living would not be in vain.
Yes.
Satan, I break your chains.
Yes.
I apply the blood of Jesus.
Yes.
I pull down every stronghold.
Yes.
And I bring every wicked spirit under subjection.
Yes.
To God's will. I loose.
Yes.
The spirit of deliverance and healing.
Yes.
And salvation, prosperity.
Yes.
Joy. Lord, let your mercy and your grace, oh God, be manifested in this place. Still the works of the enemy. Loose your handiwork. Loose your power here, oh God. And you have the preeminence, Lord. We give you all the glory.
Yes.
We give you all the praise.
Yes.
In Jesus' name.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Amen. I want to be a little obedient. I don't want to miss what I'm saying. So you might see me holding my little paper today. Maybe, by the grace of God. Amen. But I wrote it anyway. So if it fall out, that's all right. Amen. Before you minister, you must first of all identify with the people. I said, before you minister, you must identify with the people. The Bible told me, remember, that Ezekiel, when he heard he had to go, he just ran off in the heat. You know, some folks, here they are a preacher, and they just run off in the heat, get the briefcase, get the black shiny shoes, amen, comb their hair, split their hair, they buy the concordance and the exhaustive concordance, Strong's, amen, and oh, they're ready to preach, they're ready to build a church. Praise the Lord. But I drop by to say, before you do, sit. That's what the Bible told me. It said that he went to Tel Aviv and sat where they sit. Lord have mercy. Before you get your educated self, your knowing self, your powerful anointed self, running around doing God's work, remember that you are going to be ministering to people that are broken.
Yes.
People that are hurt. People that are filled with sin. People that are contaminated. People that are messed up. And you don't need to be a no high horse and get a no pulpit to pull people out of the pit of hell unless you first sit where they sat.
Yes. Yes.
Because if somebody come here to preach for you who never sit where you sat, where you never sat, where they sit, you know what's going to happen? You're going to be preaching and you're going to be well eloquent and you're going to have the finest vocabulary and the great verbosity and the nomenclature in your wordings, and you're going to bring it together, and all you're going to do is sound well. People can say you're a good speaker, but you will never touch a heart unless your heart is touched with the of their very
infirmity.
You must sit where they're seated. You must know what they're going through. You must feel what they're feeling. You must understand, amen, their weaknesses, their errors, and their problems. Don't come to judge nobody if you don't know how they feel.
That's right.
God was speaking to Moses up on Mount Sinai, whatever, you know, and he's giving him, amen, a dress code for Aaron. And what do you think Aaron doing? Aaron is sitting where the people are sitting. He's sitting with the people. He is mixed up and contaminated. But when the gifts and calling of God is upon your life, it's irrevocable. If you don't want to sit on your own and understand what they go through and feel what they're feeling, can I tell you something? You could get up on your high horse and you could go ahead and speak. You could run around and you could walk with your briefcase and all your paperwork. Like some people, you know, some people today, all they want to know, well, you didn't call me bishop. And I work real hard to be an apostle, and they'll do it, ordain me. And I've got, yeah. You can have all that, your doctorate, your PhD, all that stuff. You know, you can have PhD, THD, bishop, archbishop, pope, amen, all that stuff. But you need first a BA to be born again in your spirit, in your heart. You need to understand what people are going through. Because while Moses is getting, amen, the laws and the commandments, God is telling Moses, I want you to go down there and I want you to dress up Aaron. I want you to dress him up and I want you to put on 12, amen, buttons on him of different colors. The same that I'm going to have on the pearly gates. The same I'm going to have in heaven. Amen. And when you enter there, you're going to see this man is going to be in control of those people. They're going to have to come to him when they have their problems and their issues. And when Moses got down the hill, he saw Aaron building a calf of gold and everybody naked and everybody doing it. The men have been doing it like that. You know, they put hands differently. They're all doing their thing down there. And Aaron is there. And Moses coming with the stones and he said, how many of you know that? Moses is representing the law, legalism. Yeah. You know that is prohibited. Yeah. But God said, I'm choosing Aaron. Mm-hmm. Yes. Don't you know Moses was ready to kill Aaron? Oh yeah, he was ready to destroy Aaron because Moses knew the word. Mm-hmm. How many people you know the word?
That's right.
Huh? And all they're ready to do is kill somebody.
Yeah.
All they're ready to do is to break down somebody because they know the word.
Yeah.
And the word says so and so. Maybe Aaron was able to feel what they felt. Aaron was able to feel ashamed for the thing he did. Aaron was able to come to a place that when people, those same people that he mixed with, that he was contaminated with, that he set up, when they come to him, he could understand what they're going through. Can I move on? I have a lot to say, but I want to say it quick. Y'all get the tape, okay? Communication comes in these areas, for and with. When you're communicating to somebody, or you're speaking for someone, or you're speaking with someone. This is why Jesus sat down and thought the people. You see, when you're in this posture and you sit down, you speak with. And this is why you should be here on a Wednesday, because Wednesday I speak with you. Sunday I speak to you. Amen? And when I'm home and I'm talking to God, I speak for you. Oh, I know you missed that. Did you get what I said?
Yes.
I speak for you in my private prayer. When I'm interceding, I speak for you. When I come here Sunday morning, I speak to you.
Yes.
Amen. When I come on a Wednesday night, I speak with you.
Yes.
Because on Wednesday, you notice you could talk back to me. Mm-hmm. This is why the only talk I want on a Sunday morning is when you're praising God. Yes. When you agree with me. I don't want you to have your own conversation. Are you crazy? What church are you going to? And preaching and you yourself on your... Or you writing letters and stuff like that and you carrying on a conversation with somebody.
Right.
Come on.
Right.
Somebody say respect the house of God.
Respect the house of God.
Good communication is so important. Amen. There's power in words. You know, long ago we used to say, what's that thing you were saying? Sticks or stones can break your bones, but words can't do nothing. That's right. That's one of the biggest lies they ever set up. Because I would much rather some sticks and stones and break my bone than for you to break my heart with words. Amen. Words break hearts. Words make war. But words are also powerful enough that words, amen, a wise man in a city, Solomon says, is stronger than 10 mighty men or armies. Because one man with the right words at the right time, with good communicating skills, he can stop a war.
Yes.
Amen. I remember Carter went between Anwar Sadat and Menachem Begin. That's his name?
Menachem Begin.
Anwar Sadat.
Anwar Sadat.
Well, by the way, let me show off a little bit. Do you know I had dinner with his daughter?
Oh, really?
Well, one of these days, meet me by myself, I'll tell you. Praise the Lord. Seriously, in Washington. And she's wonderful. Very, you wouldn't believe she's who she is. Wonderful. But some people are so cultured. Amen. But guess what? Carter went in the middle of two of them to make peace. The man in the middle. Jesus went between two thieves to make peace. Amen. Beloved, we got to come to a place where we can communicate to bring peace, to bring order, to bring hope, to bring love. Amen. To men, families, to men, children from their parents. You know, some folks are so estranged with each other. We sometimes have to speak. You might have to go between. You're a child of God. Your family might be rejecting you now. They might be cussing you out now. They might be ill-speaking you. But when they get in real trouble, they know the God man to call. They know the woman who pray.
That's right.
Oh yeah, when problems come, they know who to call. So you have to live in love and walk in love continuously, that when they're in trouble, you still have an open door that they can come.
Amen.
To.
Amen.
Turn around, tell the neighbor, say, don't close the door. Don't close those doors. Keep those doors open so that people can always come to you. And do not build a wall, build a bridge. Live a life where you build a bridge. Don't build no walls. People have to climb, man. Some of us can't climb. I ain't climbing again. If you ain't have a bridge, I ain't coming. Because I ain't jumping no wall. When I was younger, I used to do that. Hallelujah. You know, the Bible says something, it says, it's not good for a man to dwell alone. Well, I know where your mind going now, you know. True, boy, you gotta have a wife. Well, a wife is not only for things that we think, you know, we, hallelujah. As soon as we have a wife and husband, we start thinking in one direction. It's not good for a man to be alone. I believe God said this really when he looked at Adam, and Adam saw all these things come up to him. Horse, donkey, act like a fool, bite and kick, monkey, and I mean all the names just fit them. Adam was so fantastic. God gave him a mind that was amazing, that he could name about 500,000 species, different things, different names, and whatsoever Adam called them, that was the name. That is how intellectually powerful and amazing God made Adam. You know, we study, and in history they show you on the Stone Age and how stupid man was, and how he was an ape, a monkey, and then he starts straightening up and stuff like that. But no, the God man was amazing. What caused man to be stupid was when he sinned. Mm. If anything. Amen. But when God saw all of these things came up to him, and they all had a partner, and they all are doing their thing, and they were able to communicate, because the snake alone could tell you that in the garden, some kind of communicating was taking place. How dare the devil use a serpent to talk to Eve? And she wasn't surprised. So don't take me back in history now. You just use your imagination. Whatever was going on, God knew now that it was not good for man to dwell alone. So he pulled out a piece of the man and had to help me. Baby, let me tell you something. Communication is so powerful that when two people connect, the three important factors in a marriage or in a relationship is sex, money, and communication. Could you say that with me? Sex, money, communication. You know, I know you don't like to hear that word. Say sex in the church. Well, let me say love, money, and communication. You know which is the most powerful? Communication. Because I'm using love to facilitate sex. Communication. Did you hear what I said?
Yes.
You know why? Because of the power of words. Because if either party starts acting crazy and one can communicate, and the other can at least listen, you know, sometimes folks don't like to listen. How many of you ever talk to somebody where you can't get in a word?
Oh,
yeah.
Huh?
Yeah. Amen.
I mean, you know, the person talking to you, woo! And you're trying to get in a word, and they're like, every time you try to get a word, blah, 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 blah. It don't work like that. Communication. How many of you ever got angry? You and your partner got angry, or you and a friend angry, because you just thought it was something.
Yeah.
But then after a while, you sit down and you talk to them, and after they communicated with you, you realize, wait a minute, I was thinking wrong, man. It wasn't really like that. And some people separate for little and nothing. Some marriages are messed up for nothing. Some people live unhappy in their homes continuously for little and nothing. And have some big fights. And they never sit down to communicate. Baby, communication is the key. Communication is powerful. Communication, word, say word. Is seed.
Seed
is able to cause you to conceive. When you are able to speak, you can cause conception in somebody. You are growing trees in that person. This is why it's not good to call people stupid and ignorant and all that stuff. Some men just take pleasure in calling the woman stupid. And I tell you, woman, you that are here and you that have daughters, don't let no man disrespect you.
That's right.
You ain't stupid. And don't let nobody make you stupid. You're not a fool. And if you're a fool, he's the one that chose the fool. So who's the bigger fool? Let me run over this. I want to get to the...